This fast healing stuff is gonna come in real handy.
In last year's segment, I talked about a very enjoyable JRPG called Persona 4, and in 2014, I actually managed to play other games in the Persona series, even the most recent ones like Persona 4 Arena Ultimax and Persona Q. So, which one of these am I gonna talk about? The answer is neither.
Wait, what?
Because there's one Persona game that topped both those games, and the surprising thing is, it came out before Persona 4. Yup, it's Persona 3 FES. Or is it FES? Whatever, I'll just call it fast, because I freaking can! Honestly, I never thought this game would be this amazing. I mean, I knew it was gonna be good, I just didn't think it would be as good as everyone else says it is. As I thought it would be inferior to Persona 4 in every way. But after playing this game, I'm glad to be 100% wrong, because this game proved to be just as amazing as Persona 4. The story revolves around a young boy who joins a team of high school students who fight shadows in a strange tower called Ktarlus, during a mysterious time period named the Dark Hour, which happens at midnight. From there, I was surprised at how different the story was compared to Persona 4. Not just the characters and settings, but also a lot of other things, like how they obtain their personas and the fact that they summon them by basically shooting their own heads with a gun-like device called an evoker. Yeesh! Rather extreme, don't you think? The gameplay is pretty similar to Persona 4, as it's split into two sections. High School Simulator, where you just do what every high school student usually do every day, and Dungeon Crawling RPG, where you level grind by defeating all manner of shadows you come across. The main difference is, where in Persona 4 you can only do one of these each day, in Persona 3, you can develop social rings by day and find shadows by night, all on the same day! The story is pretty damn dark, like, even darker than Persona 4 story, and I absolutely love every single moment. In fact, I love it even more than Persona 4 story.
You gotta be freaking kidding me!
I would explain exactly why the story is better than Persona 4 story, but I would have to spoil a lot of the game, so you had to play it by yourselves. The main cast is just as good as Persona 4's main cast. My favorites being the cheerful and one of the most overrated characters in gaming history, Yukari, the android designed to defeat shadows, I guess, the rarest class clown, Junpei, and the coolest and most badass high schooler ever, Akihiko. God, I love this handsome guy. Take me away, senpai. You were nothing! Overall, while I do very slightly prefer Persona 4, Persona 3 FES is just as amazing as its sequel, with very likable and memorable characters, very impressive story, unique gameplay, and a soundtrack?
It's some funky shit!
Ooh, yeah.
Oh, this fast healing stuff is gonna come in real handy.
You thought I was done talking about Platinum games? You thought Bayonetta was the only game they made that I actually played in 2014? Well, sorry to disappoint, or most likely the opposite of disappoint, but there's one more game they made that I liked even more than Bayonetta. And that game is Metal Gear Rising Revengeance. Holy mother of God. This is an epic game from beginning to end. You get to play as Raiden, a cybernetic ninja armed with a blade powerful enough to cut through adamantium, as you fight through armies of other cybernetic soldiers and face outstanding bosses. Hell, one of them made it into my previous list, top 15 first bosses, which I'll admit could have gone better. Click the thumbnail right here if you want to see it, but don't expect this countdown to be great or anything. Now back on topic. The story of Metal Gear Rising is a pretty good one, though it is pretty short. Like, you could clear the story in about 6 to 8 hours. Which is a shame, cause I would have loved to see some of the characters gain more screen time and development, especially Mistwall. There are DLC side stories focusing on Jetstream Sam and Blade Wolf, which flesh out their characters pretty well, and along with a lot of side missions in the VR training room, made the game last even longer. The characters are pretty likable, entertaining, and badass as all hell, especially Raiden, who can cut through anything using Blade Mode, and is voiced by Quinton Flynn. Jetstream Sam, who has the most handsome smile ever, Sundowner, who's voiced by Crispin Freeman, and that's all you need to know in order to love him, and then there's the main villain, Senator Stephen Armstrong.
Nanomachine, son!
If you guys can spell out the stupid sounding sentence that makes no sense and becomes one of the most popular memes on the internet, yet makes me laugh no matter how many times I've seen it, then that means they're doing something right. Then there's the soundtrack, which is absolutely godlike. Every single track is memorable, epic, and bumps you up with enough adrenaline to wreck a thousand Metal Gear Rays. My favorites being A Stranger I Remain, Collective Consciousness, Rules of Nature, The Only Thing I Know For Real, Hot Wind Blowing, and the theme that's playing this segment right now, It Has To Be This Way. In conclusion, Metal Gear Rising is one game that never stops being epic for a second, from the action-packed gameplay to the awesome soundtrack. Now to end this segment, here's an unrelated fight.
Alright team, I want this scum out of my house right now. Destroy them all! Rules of Nature! I am the right when the sun comes up! With the Lord on the line,
fast healing stuff is gonna come in real handy.
I bet you're still wondering why I made this a top 16 instead of a top 15 this time. Well, guess this is a good time as any to spill the beans.
Beans.
The reason as to why this is a top 16 is this game. Up next is Uncharted 2 Among Thieves. The Uncharted series is one freaking awesome franchise that for some reason I skipped when it first came out. I picked up the entire trilogy for a cheap price, played them for the first time, and my first thought was, why did I miss out on this beautiful franchise? I mean, it's made by Naughty Dog, the same people who made Crash Bandicoot, Jack and Daxter, and The Last of Us. All of them amazing games. How could I not like this series? Now to talk about Uncharted 2. While the first Uncharted game was pretty awesome, it still had a bunch of problems, mostly the fact that the aiming controls can get a bit clunky at times, and the enemies are really annoying, since they can shoot you with near perfect accuracy, and when you think you killed all of them, more of them show up to shoot you when you least expect it, making you scream at the top of your lungs. Thankfully, in Uncharted 2, their aiming is toned down, and it feels a lot less frustrating when fighting them, plus the aiming controls feel a lot smoother. The story is pretty well written, with a ton of memorable moments, like the train crashing into the Himalayan mountain, and very likable characters, except for that backstabbing dickhead, Harry Flynn. Not as able as that other British backstabber, but still really high up there. The settings and graphics were very impressive and good looking back then, and they still hold up really well today. But then again, what else did you expect from Naughty Dog? Everything they touch turns into diamond. Oh, and gold too, but diamond's a lot prettier. Now, as to why I picked this game instead of Uncharted 3, well, I think Uncharted 3 is a great sequel to Uncharted 2. It had some really frustrating moments, and even if it didn't completely ruin my gaming experience, it still annoyed me quite a bit, which is why Uncharted 2 is my favorite game of the series. It has smooth gameplay, beautiful graphics for its time, memorable set pieces, well-written story, and very likable and well-developed characters. Let's just hope Uncharted 2 will be just as awesome as this game. And to end this segment, hey Quals, what's your opinion on Harry Flynn?
I think you're a selfish bastard, and I think you can go to hell!
Oh, this fast healing stuff is gonna come in real handy.
Back in my very first countdown, Top 10 Underrated Games, I might have mentioned that Rayman 3 Udon Havoc would still be my favorite Rayman game even after I played either Rayman Origins or Rayman Legends. Guess what? I was wrong, cause Rayman Legends is the best 2D platformer and best game in the series I've ever played. First off, the graphics are really gorgeous, like every level looks very beautiful with its unique art style, and there are a lot of characters and costumes to choose from, not just Rayman, Robox, and the Teensies, but also the new character Barbara and the badass Princess Sisters, which are the characters I play as the most in the game. The levels, aside from looking very unique and beautiful, are some of the most challenging levels in video game history. I'm dead serious, most of the levels require nothing less than perfect timing just to get through the stages, especially the invasion stages and the music stages. Speaking of the music stages, these are easily my favorite part of the game. The gameplay is perfectly in sync with the music, as in, every jump and punch you make goes with the beat of the music level. That is freaking amazing! There are even other versions of these music levels where the game tries to distract you with TV static effects, and the music playing is an 8-bit remix of the original track. These were always fun to play, though it's kinda annoying when you end up dying a lot because the game threw you off with these special effects. Seriously, are you trying to give us a seizure, Ubisoft? Wasn't giving fans the middle finger by shitting out overhyped trash and unfinished garbage enough for you? I'm gonna end this segment before I go further off topic by saying that Rayman Legends is a phenomenal game with a lot of art and soul put into it, and it's currently not only my favorite Rayman game, but my favorite 2D platform of all time. Wow, that was pretty short. Should I end this with some joke I just pulled out of my ass? Nah, it's fine the way it is. Let's go to the next segment.
Oh, this fast healing stuff is gonna come in real handy.
Previously on the Omni-Slayer show. I should come up with a better title for this. Go ahead, show me how awesome it really is. I'll probably just ignore everything you say.
Alright then.
God damn it, Austin! I can't believe you got me out on another one of your beloved franchises! Again!
My work here is done.
Austin, you goddamn bastard! You've done it again! At first I was a bit skeptical about Fire Emblem Awakening. I don't know why, I just was. But leave it to Austin to clear any doubts I had in my mind. And using me as a punching bag for fighting him with Stylish Pop. Anyways, Fire Emblem Awakening is an awesome game, and I can see why everyone praises it to no end. I haven't played the Fire Emblem series mostly for one reason that I'll bring up later on, but luckily you don't need to play any of the previous games to get into this game's story. Speaking of which, the story is amazing as you play as Robin, or whatever funny name you decide to give him or her. The main protagonist helps a prince named Grom, and his team of freedom fighters named the Shepherds fight off an evil cult bent on resurrecting the fallen god. And I'll shut up now to avoid further spoilers for you guys. The cast of characters is massive, like there are a lot of characters in the game. Usually this would be a problem because, you know, quality over quantity and all that shit, but every single character manages to be incredibly likable and well developed in their own unique way. Some of my favorites include the previously mentioned protagonist, Robin, the creepy yet sexy Darkstalker mage, Tarja, the light-hearted tomboyish princess, Lisa, the handsome thief with the sweet tooth, Gaius, the tragic and depressed badass, Wanku, the always hilarious and powerful dark mage, Henry, and my favorite, the prince himself, Grom. And at some point in the game, you're able to recruit their children from
the world of tomorrow.
Shut up, Terry! As I was saying, you can recruit their children from the future as a result of pairing two units together enough times to marry them. Speaking of pairing, you can pair two units together so that the weakest of the two won't be a sitting duckwit. And after being paired enough times, they can unlock support conversations, where most of their character development takes place. These are easily the best part of the game, as these supports range from depressing, to sweet, to downright hilarious. And even the future children you recruit can have these supports. Jesus, I'm surprised with how much content they managed to squeeze in that tiny cartridge. But the one thing that sold this game to me is the fact that you can turn off the permadeath feature.
Yes!
In previous Fire Emblem games, if a unit's health bar drops to zero, they're dead and stay dead for the rest of the game, and the only way to bring them back to life is to restart the chapter all over again. And from what I've heard, the chapters were really long, and so it was a massive killjoy for many Fire Emblem fans. This is the reason that I never got into the Fire Emblem series before. But in Awakening, if a unit's health bar drops to zero, they will only retreat so that they can recover for the next battle. In short, to those who are reluctant to try out this game, you have no excuse now! Go out and buy it! It's a near-perfect game! Great story, amazing characters, beautiful presentation, phenomenal music. There are a few problems, but really, they're just minor nitpicks that you would most likely overlook it because of everything else that's flawless about this game. Now to get to the next segment before Austin kills me for putting this game at only number 4.
Too late, asswipe!
Heep!
fast healing stuff is gonna come in real handy.
Okay, I'm back everybody. So, what game am I gonna talk about next? Alright then, let's do it! Another Capcom franchise I tried out, besides the Devil May Cry series, is the Ace Attorney series. For a bunch of visual novels with a very simple point and click gameplay, these are some of the best games Capcom has ever made. The stories are very well written for the most part, the characters are very entertaining and likable, again for the most part, and the music is pretty damn memorable. They're all very enjoyable and fun to play, especially the crossover with Professor Layton. Note to self, try out the other games in the Professor Layton series. But the one I'm gonna talk about is actually the first Ace Attorney game I've ever played, as well as the first game I've played in 2014, Dual Destinies. I've already explained why I love this game so much in my audition video for the Digital Pioneers Top 10 3DS Games Contest, but let's talk about it anyway. You play as not only Phoenix Wright, but also his two young attorneys, Apollo Justice and Athena Sykes, as they defend their clients in a time where warriors fabricate evidence and prosecutors convict innocent people under false charges called the Dark Age of the Law. The characters are all as entertaining as you would expect from an Ace Attorney game, including the very intimidating prosecutor, the returned prison convict Simon Blackwell, and the bubbling over-the-top detective Bobby Poolbright, and all manner of crazy out-of-this-world witnesses that always manage to make me fall off the chair from how unbelievably funny they are. The gameplay is separated into two sections, investigation mode where you gather evidence from the crime scene, and trial mode where you use the evidence you found to pinpoint any contradictions in the witnesses' testimonies. We get returning game mechanics like Phoenix's Megatama to unlock secrets in within a person's heart, and Apollo's bracelet to point out lies by analyzing their body language for any subtle sign, and also a brand new one in the form of Athena's mood matrix, which allows her to read a person's emotions and point out any emotion that conflicts with the witness's testimonies, whether it's an unusual emotion or an unexpected lag, increase or decrease of a normal emotion. The graphics also look really amazing, opting for associated lights time that really plays off in the end. And the music is absolutely wonderful. Every music track is catchy and fits the characters and situations perfectly. I really can't find anything wrong with this game. It has a great story, awesome characters, outstanding graphics for a 3DS game, and phenomenal music that you'll be humming after finishing the last case. Though it does bother me a little bit that it's only available on Nintendo eShop as a digital copy instead of a physical copy like the other 3DS games. Seriously, Capcom, what the fuck?
Objection!
Oh, this fast healing stuff is gonna come in real handy.
Of course this game would be very high on this list. It's freaking Super Smash Bros. 4! Everyone, I mean everyone, was hyped for this game, and unlike most games that were hyped up in 2014, it lived up to all the hype. Of course the version I'm gonna talk about is the 3DS version, because like I said before, I'm too poor to get my own Wii U. While the Wii U version is unquestionably better, the 3DS version is still really damn awesome. The roster is full of great and fun characters to play as, with older characters like Link and Bowser getting a lot of buffs that make them a lot more fun to play as. And also several awesome newcomers joined the already massive roster, like Mega Man, Shulk, Pac-Man, Bowser Jr., Dark Pit, Robin, Lucina, and my personal favorite, Freaking Greninja! No, sadly some of the characters had to be cut, like the Ice Climbers and Solid Snake. But there's still the possibility of them coming back as DLC. I mean, if Mewtwo is gonna come back, then it would make sense for Lucas and Wolf to come back as well, right? Right? Moving on, the gameplay is a mix between Melee and Brawl, and with all the unique character customization, you'll be having a lot of fun for days playing by yourself or with your friends. The online feature works really well here, although there are some moments where it lags. At least it's not as bad as Brawl's online. The stages are all very diverse and beautiful, some of my favorites being Lumio City, Arena Ferox, Backmaze, Rainbow Road, Godwings, and the freaking Unova Pokemon Ring! Each of these stages have their own unique hazards, which are mostly kinda annoying, but thankfully you can turn them off by playing on the Final Destination version of the stage. That's pretty sweet! There's also the mode exclusive to the 3DS version called Smash Run, where you fight off numerous enemies from many different franchises and collect as many stat boosts as you can in a 5-minute time limit. Before facing off your opponents in a final battle where you either fight timed matches, race to the finish line, or climb to the top, it's a pretty fun mode. Hell, I've played this mode more than Classic Mode and All-Star Mode. There are a lot of other things to talk about in Smash Bros. 4, but there's a lot of content in this amazing game, a lot of modes, a lot of characters, a lot of items, and a lot of trophies to unlock. I've already played like 2 weeks straight of this game and I still haven't unlocked even half the stuff in it. That's how much content there is in the game. I would recommend this game to every Nintendo fan out there, but considering this came out like 3-4 months ago and how hyped up it was, I'm sure everyone already played this game. And also got a Wii U just to play the Wii U version of the game. Well, I can't afford my own Wii U. I'm pretty sure a lot of you already know what the number one is, but before we get there, as usual, some honorable mentions.
The only downside being that, nope, can't think of anything. This is pretty freaking awesome.
Let's skip the build up. You already know what's number one on the list. Being a huge Pokemon fan, there was no way I could place Pokemon Omega Ruby and Alpha Sapphire in any spot other than number 1. Since the remakes of the original Gen 3 games Ruby and Sapphire, we already know how the story goes. It's the same old catch Pokemon, collect gym badges, stop Team Aqua or Team Magma's evil schemes depending on what version you play, and finally face the Elite Four in the champion shtick we all got used to, and what made the Gen 3 games so great is still here with a massive amount of new additions from Gens 4, 5, and 6. Making the experience of traveling through the beautiful land of Hoenn a lot more awesome for both newcomers and veterans alike, by the physical special split, unlimited TMs, the fairy type, and of course, Mega Evolutions. This game added a lot more Mega Evolutions to other Pokemon who really needed an extra boost in their stats, including Sableye, Wapini, Altaria, Swampert, Sceptile, Beedrill, Metagross, and freaking go away! And of course, since Mega Evolutions are a thing now, that means a lot of important characters like the rival character, Archie, Maxie, and Steven have their own Mega Stones, making the fight against them a lot more challenging. Even the legendary Weather Trio get their own upgrades, with Rayquaza having its own Mega Evolution, and Groudon and Kyogre having a brand new form called Primal Reversion, which makes them 10 times more dangerous than ever. X and Y were a great way to introduce the 6th generation of Pokemon. One problem I had with that was the new lack of any post-game side quest. Thankfully, Omega Ruby and Alpha Sapphire has a lot of post-game content. Even after you finish the Delta episode, which is freaking awesome, there are a lot of other legendary Pokemon that can be caught by going through strange working portals. There's also some cool new features like the Dex Nav, which makes catching very specific Pokemon a lot easier. And you can also soar through the sky with Mega Watios or Mega Watias in order to locate mirage spots to find a lot of different Pokemon. The soundtrack can be simply described in one word: perfect. It's without a doubt the best soundtrack in gaming history, IMO. It took every single music track from the old Ruby and Sapphire and made them 1,000 times better. The only problem I had with this game is the fact that you can have rematches with the gym leaders, which honestly kinda disappointed me since it would have been a lot of fun to face them again. Only this time they had their own Megastone, making the fight a lot more intense. But it's just a small nitpick that can be easily overworked by everything else that's amazing about this game. This is the perfect remake. It took everything that was awesome about the original Ruby and Sapphire and made it 1,000,000 times better by adding all the upgrades from the later games, as well as some new features to make this not only my new favorite Pokemon game, but my all-time favorite video game. I'm the Omni-Slayer, and let us hope that 2015 will be a great year for gaming. See you guys next time!
Sum myself up in three words. I suppose it would have to be killer alien vagina.